Hey YouTube, Joyboy here. So, the official translation of One Piece chapter 997 is out. You guys know how we do the video. We talk about the official translation, compare it to the fan translation, note any difference, talk about literally anything at all, and then round out the video with comments from you guys. But once again, guys, links in the description as well as pinned in the comments for some One Piece merch. This week, Revuja's got us a pretty dope One Piece Christmas design. As always, guys, none of this goes to me. This is 100% going to the artist. If you guys appreciate what Revujo does, the artwork that he pumps out literally every single week at insane quality, then go hit that up. But yeah, to cut to the chase here, we're back to where the fan translation, the official translation are pretty close. Obviously, you read them. There's different ways of wording some things. Some people prefer one over the other. But overall in content, I can't really see any huge or significant differences that change how you view anything. Actually, this is one of those weird weeks where it's kind of strange that the translations are actually the same. They imply the same things. There was a lot of conversation, discussion over whether or not Yamato's line at the end of the chapter was going to hold and be translated the same when it came to the official, and it pretty much was. So we had the earthquake, the island obviously moved, and Momo asked Yamato what was happening, and Yamato's explanation was dragons fly through the air by creating something called flame clouds. Once again, the implication here is that this is the actual power of dragons, that, you know, dragons exist and these are the abilities that they have. This isn't a devil fruit. You know, she doesn't imply that it is a devil fruit. It is the ability of dragons. And so I've seen some people say, well, you know, keep in mind that the people of Wano don't understand that there are such a thing as devil fruits. They view them as magical powers. So then it makes sense for Yamato or for the people of Wano to view Kaido as not a devil fruit user, but an actual dragon. The difference here, though, is that Yamato was essentially raised by the Beast Pirates, and the Beast Pirates certainly know about devil fruits. Many of their top tiers have eaten them. They are not from Wano. A lot of people view this as confirmation that Kaido is a dragon for sure, dragon first, not a devil fruit user. I'm not willing to go that far. I'm not going to call this a confirmation. However, it very clearly leans in a particular direction for me. And I've obviously thought for a very long time that Kaido was a dragon because he's called the strongest creature. That's enough for me. I do not believe that Kaido is human. But there was another thing that people were looking forward to in the official translation that was also the same. See, people are wondering if Kaido is a dragon, then what is Yamato? Yamato is supposed to be his son. So then if Kaido is a dragon, you would assume Yamato is a dragon. So after the fan translation, a lot of people argued that this chapter essentially confirmed that Yamato was not a dragon because there was no chance of them escaping the island and they could fly away if he was a dragon. But the specific wording in both the fan translation I read and the official translation was Yamato said, "We're too late. We've lost our chance of escaping by sea." So here Oda clarified when he really didn't have to unless there was reason to. They can't escape by sea, but he doesn't say that they can't escape by air. They can't fly away. But yeah, there's really nothing to say as far as the differences go in this chapter, so let's get into the comments. Dragons being able to move islands makes you rethink how Wano Kuni was created in the first place with all those islands connected. So if you guys don't remember, this was a huge theory from very early on in Wano. When you look at a picture of Wano Kuni, there seems to be separated like all the different places, Kuri and the Flower Capital and Ringo and all these islands, you know, they appear to be distinct separated islands. It's a very unusual design. And so the theory was is that Wano was created by moving continents or moving islands together. The way that we made sense of this before is because of the race of continent pullers, like Oars and Oars Jr., that was their other name. Continent puller invokes the image of moving an island or moving a landmass. But now we have another way in which that feat could be accomplished because Kaido is literally moving Onigashima. Especially with Wano's history with dragons, we know Ryuma slayed a dragon. And presumably, you know, dragons weren't a thing that was foreign to the people of Wano in the past. Maybe that's dragons were what created Wano. It's really hard to fully describe this in a short period of time, but I love this theory so much. Because not only is it just cool in the short term, I think that it has huge implications for in-game concepts as well as the history of the world and the conflict during the Void Century. We've speculated that dragons with the powers that they have might be related to ancient weapons used by the ancient kingdom, the Kozuki, who created poneglyphs for the ancient kingdom. So the dragons of the past and the Kozuki in the ancient kingdom are all related. And then you have Kozuki residing on this island of Wano, maybe created by dragons. And I just have it in my mind, right, that one of a fundamental concept in One Piece is bringing people together. You see this in a lot of different connotations, circumstances throughout the story. But it's like taking various pieces, people spread across the world, and bringing them together into one piece. And then maybe here you have an actual physical manifestation of this concept brought to life. Wano itself was created by bringing islands together. But I guess the point is that dragons played some sort of fundamental, important, vital role in the history of the world. Which is also one of the big reasons why I want an actual dragon to appear in the story and be relevant, such as Kaido being a dragon. Next comment. Yo, Marco said Onigashima was called something else before. God Valley went missing. Kaido can lift islands. God Valley equals Onigashima confirmed. So I both love this idea as a concept and kind of disagree with it. We've seen a silhouette of God Valley, which looks really nothing like Onigashima. And keep in mind, God Valley was supposed to be an island where celestial dragons lived. And I think that Onigashima doesn't really give that sort of vibe as a place where celestial dragons would feel better than everybody else. You've got a giant skull on the island, essentially. That being said, right, this opens up the possibility. Rox was defeated in God Valley. The island went missing. Kaido was a member of Rox. Did Kaido take that island after the conclusion of the battle somewhere else? Clearly, Kaido has the ability. I just don't think that it is Onigashima. But we can't ignore that Marco absolutely said that Onigashima once had a different name. And of course, that will be relevant. I'll go ahead and include a link in the description to an incredible theory by Marco OPT, where he talks about some things that I now consider this my headcanon. But essentially, he brings up something that a lot of people have forgotten, that Kaido has a favorite island. This was revealed in a cover story with Caribou, and one of the beast pirates, Scotch, was there defending it. And so this was brought up in the cover story, and it's yet to find its place into the main story. But essentially, Marco connects the missing road poneglyph. We've gotten to Wano. We found two different poneglyphs in Wano. There's one in the Flower Capital, one in Onigashima. Neither was the road poneglyph that Kaido is supposed to have. So where is this road poneglyph? He argues it's in Kaido's favorite island. And that somehow, some way, the story will find its way to Kaido's favorite island. Maybe splitting this arc into two parts, because a lot of the greatest, you know, sagas in One Piece are clearly separated into two parts. You have Water 7, and then you have Enies Lobby. You have Impel Down, and then you have Marineford. So then you have Kaido and Wano splits into part two, Kaido and somewhere else. But the point of me bringing this up here now is that I think that maybe an island more likely to have previously been God Valley, in my opinion at least, might be this island. So not Onigashima. Next comment, it just dawned on me. Onigashima is Kaido's ship. Literally two islands fighting when he met Moria. Honestly, guys, as it seems to me, Thriller Bark and Moria was a treasure trove of parallels to this Yonko saga between both Big Mom and Kaido. You can find a lot of similarities between both of them with Moria. You know, Moria's abilities are very, very similar to Big Mom's, although changed in meaningful ways. The way that his island is depicted with things that should not be alive that are alive again, reminiscent of Big Mom. And then, you know, Moria fought Kaido. Kaido killed his crew, and I think that you get the sense that Kaido had a huge influence on how Moria saw obtaining power. His entire goal was to build up a force capable of getting revenge on Kaido. So what does he do? He goes to Wano, place that is relevant to Kaido, and he finds a giant oars. And we know Kaido has an entire division of freakish giants. And his other most important zombie was a legendary samurai. And we know that Kaido had essentially subjugated the samurai. So Moria's forces was a little small representation of what was to come with Kaido. But yeah, guys, if you want to take the time to look, there are a lot of little things which connect to current events. Lola the zombie was Big Mom's daughter, and that led into the Big Mom saga. An important concept within Moria's arc was Absalom's ability of invisibility, and Sanji badly wanted that, and then in this arc, it's revealed that he now has that ability. One of the interesting things about Thriller Bark was it was one of the few times that we've seen an all-out fight against one opponent, where the entire Straw Hat crew fights against Orz, and many people think the same thing might occur with Kaido, except for this time replaced with the Supernova. And I also wonder whether the end of this arc may be reminiscent as well. After the Strats were able to defeat Moria, another opponent revealed themselves, and they were not capable of fighting them. This is something very unique to Thriller Bark. This has not happened at any other point in the story where the Strats beat their opponent and then are blindsided by a completely new faction or new enemy arriving. And here in this arc, this entire plan developed to attack and defeat Kaido, but not a lot of thought or consideration has been placed on Big Mom. And because Big Mom and Kaido's alliance is such a big deal to the world and the Marines, and there's ties to the Revolutionary Army as well, you wonder if another faction might make an appearance at the end. For me personally, guys, this is just a very baseline thought about how you can potentially split the Kaido arc into two parts, where you're fighting Kaido in Wano. But how do we get somewhere else? Why does Kaido leave Wano? Well, maybe it's not because of the Straw Hats, but because the Marines arrive and he realizes that he's not prepared for this fight. And at the same time, what this would accomplish is this would definitely open Wano's borders. Maybe not the way that we all thought or Odin intended, but, you know, same thing. But to get back to the comment in question, for there to be parallels between Moria, whose ship was a literal island, to Kaido, whose ship is a literal island, makes a lot of sense to me. We've never actually seen Kaido's legitimate ship. I mean, every pirate crew, it's very important. Oda loves designing pirate ships. The Big Mom Chanter and, you know, the Straw. Like, every pirate crew has a ship. The Moby Dick. What is Kaido's ship? It's got to be special. Onigashima certainly fits that. Next comment, Kaido always had his eyes set on Wano from the start out of revenge for his father being cut down by Ryuma. So another reason why I like Kaido as a dragon is it makes his backstory so much more interesting. Essentially, the last dragon, all the dragons have been killed. You know, maybe the mother of Yamato has been killed. We don't exactly know. But as far as the dragon that Ryuma slayed being Kaido's father, I'm not there yet. Just because I've read Monsters, and that dragon did not seem like an Eastern dragon like Kaido at all. It didn't have any of these same abilities. So I do view it as a dragon, and it is supposed to be canon to One Piece's history, but it's a different variety of dragon. It's not the same. However, if there's an established connection between dragons and Wano, absolutely there could be something here. Next comment, Kaido's going to be revealed as an actual dragon by dumping him into the ocean, only for him to fly out of the water completely unconcerned, calling him. I mean, this is what they say about Kaido. He is the strongest on air, land, and sea. The strongest creature. Eastern dragons, absolutely in mythology, are underwater beings as well. This is alluded to as well with Ryugu Palace. If you guys remember, Fishman Island, the castle itself, there was a huge dragon, Eastern dragon design on it. And this all relates to stories of dragons from Japanese mythology. Yes, they could travel underwater. And as other comments have pointed out, a huge question within the community for literally 10 years is, if Kaido wanted to kill himself so badly, why didn't he just throw himself into the ocean, right? He's a devil fruit user, not a kind of creature that can breathe underwater, so you're dead. Not in this case. But let's get into the next comment. This time we're going to switch gears and talk about Sanji. Not hitting women is a big part of Sanji's character, and if we take that away, he's just not Sanji anymore. Guys, one of my mottos, one thing that I try to always embrace, is that your opinion today is not necessarily reflective of your opinion tomorrow. A lot of people see it as a bad thing when your opinion changes. And I just, as long as it's honest, I don't agree with that. Life is about constantly learning. You're not always right, 100% right from the start. To be quite honest with you, I find my opinions on Sanji slowly changing for years upon years. I've thought that Sanji not hitting women is wrong and something that needs to be addressed. And changed. And I still think this to some degree. But I find my mind, especially recently, being opened to the possibility that it doesn't happen. We can think about it like this, right? There's two distinct things about Sanji and which prevents him from reaching his full potential as a fighter. He won't hit women, and he won't use his hands in combat. And so, technically, I think that these two things are very similar, right? If Sanji needs to use his hands in order to defeat an opponent, then he should do that, right? But for some reason, we think about these two things completely differently, where Sanji never using his hands, okay, that's something that he has to live or die by. But Sanji refusing to hit women, even when they threaten him and his friends, that's just wrong. Why do we think like this? What's the difference between the two situations? The answer that I've come to is that people just fundamentally disagree with the philosophy that not refusing to hit a woman, even when they are violent and dangerous, is really chivalry or respect for that woman. On the flip side, not using his hands because his hands are sacred to him as a chef is something that philosophically we can agree with, even if that were to at some point actually be something that costs him. I think I'm growing to understand that a very important theme in One Piece is the characters sticking to their ethics. For me, this seems highlighted in the story recently when you compare Trafalgar Law to Luffy as captains. You can also see a bit of this between Odin and, say, Shinobu. There exists this concept of winning, no matter the cost. A lot of people in the story believe this, and a lot of people in real life believe this. The ends justify the means. But you'll find that the heroes generally don't operate based on this premise. Why is that? That's because winning the fight is not the most important thing to them. I find myself understanding this a bit better than maybe I did before. You know, this is one of the fundamental philosophies of One Piece that a lot of people really love, but do they really understand it? The D's, they smile before they die. They smile in defeat. Why is it? Why are they so joyed or happy? Or, you know, all their dreams just came crashing down. You know, they'll die. Everything that they love might be sacrificed. Why would you smile? It's because they don't fear death and they don't fear defeat. This relates to the many conversations that we've had recently about Buddhism. When you die, your soul is reborn. What is most important to a Buddhist is living your life to the best possible extent that you can, the right way. Also important is to lose your attachment to life, because there's something far greater that we're all striving to achieve. I think that all of this relates to Sanji and whether or not he should or should not hit a woman. I think that as long as Sanji believes in the story that this is the way that he should live his life, then it's not really important if he loses because of it. I think that this whole conversation really is about changing for the right reasons. Is Sanji going to hit a woman because he fears death? Because he fears losing these things that are important to him in this life? Or is he changing because he believes that it is the right thing to do? Next comment, I believe Sanji's chivalry will captivate Black Maria like he did with Violet on Dressrosa. So related to the conversation that we just have, if it's important for Sanji to stand by what he believes, as long as he believes it, then it doesn't matter if you lose because of it. So then, obviously, the Straw Hats aren't going to lose, so Oda needs to sort of cultivate the story around this, and basically Sanji wins despite it. Now, obviously, we have it in our minds right now that Black Maria is not really the same as Violet, just because Violet was always going to be antagonistic to Doflamingo, whereas Black Maria's stance within the story is not quite as fleshed out, at least not at this point in time. Black Maria seems to be very loyal and fawning of Kaido. But I just want to remind you guys that Black Maria is a Flying Six, a Tobi Roppo. They are former pirate captains that have been subjugated through fear by Kaido. And Black Maria is probably, as a spider, very manipulative. We don't know if she's telling the truth or not. We don't know what exactly that it is that she wants. And so one of the themes that I find, or not a theme, but, you know, it seems a lot of things are stacking together, is that the Straw Hats are taking Kaido's allies. You have Tama with her Kibidango, might tame Smile Fruit users, various creatures in Wano, maybe they subjugate the giants. To me, it seems very clear that the ninja are not loyal to Kaido for his betrayal of Orochi, and they're just kind of looking for an excuse to switch sides. That's the impression that I have at any rate. Chopper might be the one to save many members of the Beast Pirates, so then they might switch sides. Apu as well is just like Queen, you know, Queen just basically attempted to kill him. Big Mom Pirates might become allies. We've already got Drake on board. A lot of people question Sasaki. It would be really interesting if Black Maria turned out to be an ally or became an ally because of Sanji. Luffy's great power, and to a lesser extent his pirate crew, the Straw Hat Pirates, their great power is their ability to influence the hearts of their enemies. The way that it seems to me, the way that Oda appears to be setting this up, is that this arc is going to embody that more so than any arc ever. So yeah, I'm intrigued. Next comment, I've been pondering how Sanji will take on his next female opponent for a while. I know for sure Sanji will never ever hit a woman even if she beats him to death. I looked back into Sanji versus Caroline, queen substitute of Kamabaka Kingdom. In that fight, Caroline dodges all of his attacks while looking at his groin to make him modest. And when she finally attacks using a Maiden's Awakening, an attack that wasn't actually a strike, but an embracing hold that was strong enough to turn Sanji into an Okama and make him lose sight of who he really was. Sanji stayed on the Kamabaka Kingdom to learn the techniques. It stands to reason he may have adapted this fighting style of not actually hitting a woman, but to instead, let's say, free her maiden heart. I know it's a stretch, but I honestly see no other way of Sanji actually fighting a woman. So guys, this is a more like fleshed out idea of essentially the same idea proposed by the previous comment, but I wanted to include this because it's just really interesting to me, because having the debate that we just had, it might be important for Oda to devise a way for Sanji to win without hitting a woman, and this is as good of an idea as I've ever seen. And I do think that there's some power in this, like Black Maria repeatedly attacking, hurting, harming Sanji, and then, you know, Sanji embraces her, seriously, without the intent of harm. Take my life if you must. It's honestly not all that different from Zoro turning around and opening his arms in front of Mihawk saying, "Scars on the back are a swordsman's shame. I've been bested, might as well take it like a champion." Next comment, I'm getting a bit worn out on you constantly driving your theory of the Straw Hat's loss. If you think I'm bad, check out Mr. Morge. You know, this is a fair comment, and honestly, I understand it. It's hard to follow somebody whose opinions you disagree with. You know, let's just talk about politics, for instance. You're not going to go out of your way to go watch a news channel that has a particular political leaning that you don't agree with. You may be able to watch a few, but eventually you'll get tired and you'll find something that you like. I do think that disagreement slowly like beats you down and you lose that patience. Especially when it's repetitively the same idea. But so here's the thing, this is not something that I'm willing to compromise on, because at the end of the day, this is a theory channel, it's a speculation channel, and in order to speculate about the future, you have to make some assumptions. And I'm not out here, you know, I say exactly what it is that I think, what I believe when I believe it. Yes, sometimes it does change, but I'm always telling you guys what I think. Whether the Straw Hats win or lose in this arc is vital, just the same as in Whole Cake Island. Whether or not Big Mom becomes an ally or an enemy long term in the future of her story is vital. I want it understood that I'm not 100% that the Straw Hats are going to lose. It's not 100%, but it is where I lean right now, and so as I actually believe that and I lean that way right now, it affects how I see the story going forward and the possibilities. I also generally just find it more interesting from that perspective, which is kind of a want, which may make me a little bit biased, but I try to think these things through. But yeah, for the sake of your comment here, I want to argue from the perspective that the Straw Hats win. How do I see that happening? And I do think that there's avenues for this to actually happen. As we said earlier, the Straw Hats essentially converting most of Kaido's forces, most of Kaido's allies. That's an important step in my mind. All of Wano rising up together in order to face Kaido. That's another thing that I could see happening. All the supernova. And then you have Big Mom. I see a pathway, and I've always seen a pathway for Big Mom to become an ally through her crew and her illness and things that she doesn't understand. And so, yes, for a long time, I believed that, you know, Big Mom might join the side of the Straw Hats, or at the very least, might her role as an enemy directly to the Straw Hats might be lessened. Throw in some things like Big Mom fundamentally disagreeing with Kaido, his treatment of Wano, people in Wano that Big Mom might have befriended, like Tama. And then her own relationship with her family, killing them but not doing so while she was conscious or in control. Time and time again, it is repeated that many of the Big Mom pirates aren't happy. They're not satisfied. They're not free. And they finally put their foot down and stop Big Mom's tyranny and say, "Enough's enough. We love you as our mother, but this isn't okay. Kaido is everything that we stand against. We cannot join an alliance with them." So then essentially you have Kaido, King, Queen, and Jack against everybody else. That's a fight that they could potentially win. In this way, somehow Big Mom's plot lines are resolved. Maybe Kaido kills Big Mom. And then I also see that this arc separating into two parts. So then Kaido, realizing he's defeated, maybe the Marines show up at the end, he leaves, and then the fight follows him. But you guys also know that I'm a believer in Sanji versus Zoro and Zoro versus Luffy. This is just something I know a lot of people disagree, but this is how I see the story taking place. So in order to make this into something, you need this victory, even if it is a victory, to feel like a loss, which I think would require casualties, such as the Scabbards, maybe others. I've always been in love with the idea that, you know, Big Mom sort of goes rogue, she goes on a rampage, maybe she steals the life force of members of the Straw Hat crew itself. It's been low-key hinted in Whole Cake Island that when Big Mom steals the life force out of people, they can actually be returned, because Moscato was killed at the start of the arc and then showed up at the end of the arc. So then that would be a very plausible, interesting way of killing a Straw Hat without fully killing them, I guess. It would be an evolution of what we saw in Sabaody, when Kuma was sending all the Straw Hats flying, Luffy believing that they had died, but then shortly after this realizing that what was happening to him was happening to them. But in this case, it's even more real because they don't understand how Big Mom's abilities actually work. Their bodies would be there limp and dead. And it requires Big Mom or Big Mom's soul, the black shadows that we saw in Whole Cake Island, to put that life force back. Which would mean that you would need the Big Mom Pirates on your side. And that would lead to a lot of emotional moments, for which I believe will happen and am looking forward to. And also, I just imagine if everything goes right, literally everything goes right, they steal all of Kaido's allies, the Big Mom Pirates stop being enemies at some point in time, or are some way distracted, and you still aren't able to defeat Kaido, and he's able to leave. Luffy and Zoro were not strong enough to deal the final blow. And they also weren't able to discover Kaido's road poneglyph. I think that that would leave them feeling very unsatisfied. And so when we get to part two, they're even stronger than they were before. But yeah, just understand that I have these thoughts too. Obviously, maybe it's not like what you would expect from a victory, but I basically see this as a victory. Forcing Kaido to leave Wano, opening up the borders, it's essentially the same thing. Hard to quantify that as a loss. Next comment, hey Joy Boy, notice an interesting parallel involving your thoughts on Zoro. Him taking Luffy's opponent and the potential fallout from that in this chapter, Marco specifically mentioned that he was searching for his role in the war, even directly asking for one, implying that he knows he needs to defer to the leader of this fight in order to help where he fits best. Playing your role, Sanji saying do what you can to the best that you can in Enies Lobby. Could this be related possibly to his experience as a pirate? Oda-style hinting of what is right, Marco, and what is wrong, Zoro, in practice. I just want to make this very clear, right? Never once, not once in the story, has Zoro ever fought somebody that Luffy had prior claim to. That Luffy was dead set on fighting, and was actually there in order to tell Zoro this. And that's what makes this situation so interesting and different from anything that we've ever seen before. A lot of people say, well, I know what's going to happen. But we're in uncharted waters. When Luffy marks his opponent, Zoro doesn't question that, he doesn't interfere. And the same is true in reverse. It's just throughout the story, they've never really ever had a moment like this where Luffy was dead set on defeating someone, that defeating someone was important for him achieving his dreams, and then that simultaneously being true for Zoro. So I just want to pose a thought experiment based on what we know. What if Luffy tells Zoro to not fight Kaido? What do you think happens? I don't think that that ends well. People will obviously say, they'll say, well, Luffy will see reason, right? To Yonko, you can't possibly defeat To Yonko. And that's what Zoro believes. Zoro thinks that he sees reason, right? Not only is Kaido an opponent that makes sense to him, for him to achieve his dreams, he needs to cut Kaido because Kaido is uncuttable. That makes sense. There's another Yonko here, so Luffy needs him up there. All of this makes sense to Zoro. All of this makes sense to the readers. But it may not make sense to Luffy, because in Luffy's mind, so far, at least, Kaido is an opponent that he has decided that he must be able to defeat by himself in order to become the King of the Pirates and find the One Piece. I've seen other people say, well, the fight against Kaido is going to be an all-out fight with all the Supernova, and I don't disagree. For sure, Kid, Law, and Luffy are all going to go up against Kaido, and so why not just add Zoro in there as well? He's a Supernova. But you have to understand the context of these three fighting together to face Kaido. They're not happy that the other ones are there. They want the glory, especially Kid and Luffy, they want the glory for themselves. They want the accomplishment, the feat for themselves. They are competing against one another. So from this standpoint, Zoro being there as well as competition to Luffy doesn't make sense. Or at least is intriguing. The reality here as I see it, what Zoro needs to understand is that Luffy is the captain and he's the one who makes these decisions. The way that the Strat Crew operates is that you count on each member pulling their weight. If they say that they will do something, then you have to believe in them. And the same is true of Zoro to Luffy. Luffy says he's going to defeat all of the Yonko, Kaido, and then Big Mom. Then Zoro needs to believe that he will accomplish this, even when it doesn't make sense. This concept was beautifully highlighted at the end of Whole Cake Island with Jinbei. First, Jinbei showed deference to Luffy, and he asked Luffy if he could go save his crew and stay behind. But the second thing, and just as important, Luffy didn't see how Jinbei would actually survive. That was written all over his face. But Jinbei said that he would do it. He said that he would come back alive. And Luffy says, all right, but just understand that I am your captain. So do what it is that you say. This is an order. Luffy trusted in Jinbei, and here he is in Wano. The same thing applies to Zoro now. Has Zoro ever asked Luffy if he could take Kaido as an opponent? There are many, many ways to do this wrong, and only a few ways in which you can do this right. But essentially, I believe, just like Jinbei, that Zoro has to beg Luffy to fight Kaido, because that was Luffy's mark first. And he's gotta do so in a respectful way. Essentially, he can't say, I don't think that you can win. I mean, this is an important question. What is the motivation behind Zoro's obsession with fighting Kaido? Does he want to fight Kaido because of his own personal reasons? Because he sees Kaido as being a vital opponent to achieving his dreams? Or is it that he doesn't think that Luffy is going to win? If this third thing is true at all, it is a cardinal Straw Hat sin. If Zoro goes to Luffy and says, I need to defeat Kaido in order to achieve my dreams, that is a way in which maybe he could reach Luffy. Or if Luffy comes to the conclusion himself that he needs Zoro and asks Zoro to join the fight. Again, this is another thing that is vital to how the Straw Hat crew operates and their dynamic. When a Straw Hat says that they are going to do something, like when Sanji says, hey, I'm going to go to Whole Cake Island, be right back, you have to trust them. Zoro understood this in Zou, right? Sanji said he was going to do something, so we got to leave him to it. But at the same time, Luffy has an even deeper understanding of this and intuition of the situation. I should probably ask Sanji exactly what he thinks, because something feels off. Luffy gave him an opportunity to ask for help. Until he asks for help, then Luffy can't help him. Same thing is true in Arlong Park. The Straw Hats don't do anything until Nami asks for help. Guys, Oda understands how this works. In Zou, Luffy turned to Momonosuke and like, are you going to ask me for help, or are these people going to talk for you? This same thing applies to the Kaido fight. Zoro has to wait for Luffy to ask for help if he believes that Luffy needs it. Until he does, Zoro cannot fight Kaido. But it appears to me, at least up until this point, that Zoro has just assumed that he's going to fight Kaido. He hasn't asked for permission. He hasn't shown any deference or respect. This is just what he is going to do. And that's interesting. So the way that I see this right now is Luffy and Zoro end up on the roof at the same time. And people are like, well, what is Luffy gonna say to Zoro? You don't fight Kaido, I've got this? That is a very reasonable possibility. Guys, the nuance here is, it depends on if Luffy is being honest. Does he really believe that he is going to defeat Kaido and then Big Mom? And if he doesn't actually believe this, you have another set of problems. And so this leads me back to sort of the premise of this comment, where maybe Oda is foreshadowing this or highlighting the difference here between Marco and Zoro in the very same chapter. Marco says, tell me what to do. And Zoro says, I am going to do. I didn't mention this in my first reaction to the video, but it seems pretty telegraphed to me that Zoro is going to use Marco to get up onto the roof. So they're going to show up at the same time, and we might, you know, we'll see what happens. Honestly, guys, I think that if Luffy actually tells Zoro to stay out of the fight, Zoro is going to fight anyway. And yes, this will lead to problems. But yeah, guys, I had so many more comments that I wanted to talk about between Luffy and Zoro. Obviously, I find this to be very relevant right now, but the video is already at 33 minutes, and I know that that's another thing that really wears on a lot of people. You guys know where I stand. Eventually, it just becomes background noise, and people turn off to the whole argument, but We'll obviously see where it goes from here. I read all your guys' comments. I believe what I believe. And, you know, let's play. If it does end up happening, you guys know that I'm going to have that long explained video for you if you don't get it. And if it doesn't happen, you guys know I'm going to take that L as silently as I possibly can. On the inside, I will be crying, but it do be like that sometimes. But yeah, guys, as always, curious as to what you guys think. Leave your thoughts in the comment section below. Like the video if you like the video, dislike the video if you dislike the video, subscribe if you want to be notified for my future content. And as always, guys, have a wonderful day.